2023. It's awesome to be here. This is the best place to start the tone of your year. Let's worship God together.
God's done great things, and he's not done. Let the sound of heaven come and flood the earth. Let the saints rise up as your glory fills the church. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. Hey! He is always good and his love endures forever. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all the earth below. He is worthy, worthy. Praise God, all you Son and Holy Ghost. He is worthy, worthy. Praise God. Oh, praise God. Oh, praise God. Oh, praise God. For the blind eyes. For the blind eyes open. For the lost ones saved. Our hands and we magnify his name. For the Lord is good and his love endures forever. Hey! He is always good and his love endures forever. Praise God from whom our blessings flow. Praise him all the earth. The trumpet sounds, every eye will see, and every knee will bow. All the glory and power to Christ our King.
This is such a special day. Such a special day. Because I believe this year is going to be a year of transformation. It's going to be a year of transformation that will change everything. And it's hard, but it's worth it. It's work, but it's worth it. What you put in is what you're going to get.
This week, I really felt like...
It's on.
There we go. This week I really felt like, I told David, I said, I really feel like the Lord wants to do something in our first service. That it, there's been times that we as people, I was almost hesitant to dream, to have goals, to press into what expectations this new year might have, because I don't know if any of y'all have felt like that, but the last 2 years have been like, well, alrighty then, I've been a little blindsided. And when you get blindsided, sometimes you lose vision. Sometimes you lose what is really what we're supposed to see. And I feel like that the Lord wants to correct some vision in here. He wants to for us to come into the eye doctor this morning. I don't know about y'all, but every time I've gone to the eye doctor and I get my eyes checked, when they say, is this better or is this better? Is this better or is this better? I'm like, they look the same. And when I get, it's true. I'm like, I'm guessing here. And what happens is they can't give me a prescription on guessing that's going to let me see what I need to see. And so a lot of times when we don't see things the way that God wants us to see things, we are blindsided, that we lose some things, that we really lose how God wants us to be able to go through this next year. There might have been some things that happened that you didn't expect, that blindsided you in relationships, in your finances, in your children, in your businesses, whatever the case may be, that whatever has blindsided you to where you have a perception of what you think that looks like, we need to clear up our vision and go, God, give me eyes to see what you, what, if there's no hope in this relationship, Lord, I need hope. Lord, my finances are a mess and I don't know if I'm ever going to be able to come out of this pit. Lord, my kids are not living the way that I want my kids to live. Whatever your situation may be, God wants to fix our vision this morning.
Man, that's good.
When Jesus prayed for the blind man, the one that he spit in his eyes. Now, he healed several blind people, but the one that he spit in his eyes, I'm like, y'all, we all getting spit on this morning. Because wouldn't you have liked to have been the one that said, be healed in Jesus' name? But this guy was, and so this is the thing, as fathers, as sons, as mothers, as daughters, as individuals, as a church, as a community, as followers, as leaders, what he wants us to do is go, let me do some eye surgery here. Let me correct what you think is failed expectations and look to go, this isn't going to frustrate you this year.
That's good.
This relationship, I'm working, but you can't see it.
Good.
And so when he healed the blind man, he said, what do you see?
He said,
I see people like trees. and he prayed again. He could only fix his vision on what he told him he saw. They're only able to prescribe a prescription to me on what I tell them that I'm seeing. And so you may be vulnerable this morning and go, Lord, I want a change. I don't want to go into this year with the same vision and the same thought process and the same attitude.
That's
and
right.
The same, I don't want to make the same mistakes. We have to change our vision then. We've got to be able to see it differently. And so it may take you being vulnerable this morning. It may take you going, I'm going to put my pride down, Lord, even if they don't change. What I'm going to see is going to be different. Even though that man, nothing in that changed. That whole whole thing changed, but his perception of what he saw changed. And that's where we have to get this morning of that. Your circumstances may not change, but your perception of them has got to change in order to not make the same mistakes. If we can see straight,
good.
We can live straight.
Come on.
If we can see right, we can make right choices.
Good.
And so when we get our vision corrected, when we get our vision lined up with what the Word of God says, then we're able to make those decisions based on, I'm not going by what I see, Lord. I'm going by what the Word of God says.
That's
that
good.
No matter how hopeless it may look, you are my hope.
Yep. Man,
and
that's
so,
good.
And it may be you're needing to change your vision of what you see or how you see it. In Acts 3, when Peter was preaching, he told them, he said, you need to repent of your sin and you need to turn. And then times of refreshing of the Lord will come.
Man, that's good.
And a lot of times we just need a refreshing from the Lord. And it may just come from simply, I'm sorry, God. Mm-hmm. And your vision will begin to clear up.
It's good.
I'm able to make choices now, not based on my sin and what rejection has done and what loneliness has done and what all these other things that have done to me that have blindsided me. But I'm able to make a decision now based on he's going to come because I've repented of my sin and he's going to refresh me.
Man, that's good.
And I'm going to get clear vision.
Man.
And so for our house this morning, wherever you are, in whatever situation, don't leave 2022 and come into 2023 with the same vision, the same mentality, the same attitude. Because this is the thing. It's scary to step out and believe God again when we've had the last 2 years of what we've had. We don't know what's going to happen. Neither did Peter when he stepped out on the boat.
Yep.
And I'm not about to stay in the boat and just live vicariously through somebody else's faith. I can't go by what his vision of what the Word says. I've
got to
get in the Word and see what the Word says for my life.
So good.
I have to step out.
Man, that's good. Man, that's good. Father, we thank you for today. And we come to you, we gather here today, Father God, to honor, to worship, and to give you praise. Because only through you can you put back a life.
Yes.
Only you can bring the broken pieces back together and make them whole and work the way you have designed us to work, to live, Father. It says the kingdom of heaven is joy and peace in the Holy Ghost. And Lord, we thank you for joy and peace this year in the Holy Ghost. And we give you the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Happy New Year, everybody. Happy New Year, everybody.
It's a big day. I just want to encourage you. Next time it's the praise and worship's fully engulfed like it was, I want to encourage you to come up front, because there's nothing like being up front and being in the middle. I've been in praise and worship as the sound guy for, I guess, off and on for 15 years, I guess, or whenever. But there was a lot of times where it felt like in a room full of people, I was all by myself. And there's nothing like getting up here and even being just right there. And that's church, is when the praise and worship's pouring it out and the people behind you are pouring it out. It sounds like you're just in a, you can never replicate that. And so I encourage you, next time you feel led to get up here, just come stand up here and get your toe in the water and watch what God will do in your life. But so this morning I want to go to chapter 10 in Luke, and it says, now it happened in verse 38. It says, now it happened as they went that he entered a certain village, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary who sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving. And she approached him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me. And Jesus answered her and said, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed. And Mary has chosen the good part. In some accounts it says the greater thing, which will not be taken away from her. And I just want to say thank you to all the places that you could have been last night and this morning. You chose to be here today. And God will honor your faithfulness. I was visiting with Seth. I said, yesterday Seth come by and we were visiting, and I said, you know, 5-10 years ago, I'd have made the night party and the morning church service, but my 30s has talked me out of that. So thank you. And The title of my message this morning, it says, the title of my message this morning is An Eternal Mindset. In Ecclesiastes 3, verse 9, in Ecclesiastes, you talk about seasons in your life, seasons come and go, and new years, new things are happening. It's new season. It's a new season in life. And in Ecclesiastes 3, verse 9, it says, what profit has the worker from that in which he labors? I have seen the God-given task which the sons of men are to be occupied. In other words, you got a job, you're to be occupied, you're to be doing. And he has made everything beautiful in its time. Also, he has put eternity into their hearts, except that no one can find out the work of God that God does from beginning to end. I know that nothing is better for them than to rejoice and to do good in their lives, and also that every man should eat and drink and enjoy the good of all his labor. It is the gift of God. And today you have chosen to start off this year in a good place. In Genesis, God spoke and he created, and creation has yet to stop creating and existing. It's going to be a new year and a new year, a new you. The gym memberships, the what do you call it, New Year's resolutions, so on and so forth. I always, you know, like you just kind of like, well, let's just wait and see what happens, you know, instead of no promise is better than a broken promise, you know. And aside from what's going on in the world today, what do you want to look back this time next year and say, I got what I set out for? I started today and I had a vision for what my year would look like next year. And that's where we have to get out of this temporal mindset and start thinking past the end of our nose. Right now it feels good. It feels good, but it ain't always good for me. And I'll keep going, but New Year's resolutions and new goals for the year. You're fast. What decision do I need to make today to start that process? Am I building my eternity today, or am I just living for the moment? What's good for me doesn't always feel good. And I look back, and I was getting ready for this message, and I look back at my time alone, and there was deaths in the family. My grandpa died. It was probably one of the most devastating times in my life to be alone. You know, I wanted, nobody wants to be alone, but, you know, you're going through this. But I was in a place of, if God wasn't enough for me in my life, no one was ever going to be good enough for me. You know, because a lot of times we think our significant others or relationships are what bring us close to God. And God's like, hey, man, that's good. That's a gift for me and all that's good. But if I'm not good enough for you all by yourself, then they cannot be your God in your relationship. And in order to be a good husband, I had to learn to feel what it was like to be alone and be okay with that. At the time, it didn't feel good going through some of the darkest times of my life, but it was good for me. Because I now know what it feels like to be in rejection. It wasn't God's will for me to make those choices that I did to get to that place, but there is always a way. I want to tell you this morning, don't quit, hang in there, and God's will be done. Jesus at Gethsemane, Matthew chapter 26 and verse 36, it says, Jesus then came to a place, and this is where I'm talking about, man, when you feel like you're alone, you feel like the world is coming down on you, like 2021 and 2022, it was like, how much worse can it get? You know, and I remember going through these alone times in my life, and God's like, hey, you're going to have to see this through. You're going to have to go through these things. And it brought me to this passage with Jesus at Gethsemane, and that means that word Gethsemane, if you look it up, it's a place of crushing. It's a place of mashing. It's not a fun place to be, and we've all been there, and if you're not there, you will get there. You know what I'm saying? In your Christian walk, you're going to go through some things that it's going to bring you to a place of pressing, a place of the threshing floor. I don't want to get ahead of myself, but it says, he tells his disciples, sit here while I go and pray over there. And he took with him Peter and two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me. And he went a little further and fell on his face, praying, oh, my Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. And that's what you're going to have to do is when you, in this year and going forward, when things come into your life, you're going to have to look at that situation and measure up to the Word of God and say, is this good or is this good for me? Does this feel good or is this good for me? This spot where I'm at right now is a place of crushing, but what's it going to bring forth in my life? Yeah, it doesn't feel good. And Jesus knows he's headed to the cross, and he's going to go pray to his Father. And how I always think, if Jesus has to endure knowing that he's going to the cross, he goes to his dad and says, God, if this cup can pass from me, let it pass. And how many times in our life when we say, man, if you'll just get me out of this, if you'll just get me out of this, I'll do better. You know, I've been there. I'm going to be the first one to say, Lord, if you just get me through Monday, I promise I won't do it again on Saturday. You know what I'm saying? I've been there. You know what I'm saying? But Jesus, knowing that he had to go to the cross and to despair and agony in his life, sweat and blood in some accounts it says, but he says, you know what, God, not my will be done, but your will be done. And what good come from that? And we measure that up with our lives. Man, it don't feel good right now, but it doesn't feel good, but it's good for me. We don't always see that kind of tough love, that God love, that says get up and try again, or hey, you stay in the mud with the pigs, or you get up, or you can get out and come with me. In Revelations, God is talking to the lukewarm church. Everybody say, I am the church. Okay, everybody take a deep breath, because this is where they're talking. He's writing in red, and it's the third chapter of Revelation. He's talking to the seven churches, and he is not happy, to say the least. But it says, these things says the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of creation of God. I know your works, that you are neither hot nor cold. And this is where I want to, we're not here to bash you this morning. We're here to challenge you. We want to see good in your life. And you make this decision. You get to make this decision in your life. We don't get to make it for you. And it says, I know your works, that you're neither hot nor cold. I could wish you were hot or cold. So then, because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, cold nor hot, I will vomit you out of my mouth. Because you say I am rich, have become wealthy, and have need of nothing, and do not know that you're a wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you to buy from me gold refined in the fire, that you may be rich, and white garments, that you may be clothed, that the shame of your nakedness may not be revealed, and you anoint your eyes with the salve, that you may see. As many as I love, I rebuke and I chasten. It don't feel good, but he loves me. Therefore, be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice, and you say, what is that voice? Because you hear about the voice, well, what voice? It's that calling, that I know God has a better life for me voice. That deep down inside, I know God's got something better for me. But that's the voice he's talking about right here. It's that uneasy feeling. I got plum teared up yesterday, but how heavy it is sometimes standing up here knowing that God's got a word. And man, you can't sleep, you can't eat, you can't laugh, you can't cry. You know what I'm saying? It's like, man, it's heavy. I just need to get this out of me because it's heavy. But that's that uneasy feeling that, man, I don't want you to miss out on something. I'm just going to do it. I told Seth, I said, man, there's 10 more guys out there that can do it 10 times better than me all the time. And it's like, God, there's somebody out there better. But you know what? I will never not do this. If God calls me to do it, I'm going to do it, whether I want to or not, because I don't want you to miss out on what God's saying and what God has for your life because I didn't feel like it today. You know, even in my mess, I'm not standing up here saying that we got it all together. I mean, anytime you've heard us preach, you know that we don't have it all together. You know, I have story after story of the ranch life and my sons, and, you know, I've got a spank cast 3 times a week, and then yesterday Cannon got him a dose, and I'm like, holy crap, this boy could put cast in his pocket and walk away with him. You know, he is something else. But sorry, And I'll go back to it. And he says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me." And you need to, if you're writing in your Bible, I underline in my Bible, but in verse 21 it says, and you need to underline this, it says, "To him who overcomes," you just jot that down. In other words, you're going to go through a mashing and you're going to think you're alone, you're going to think God's mad at you, but it says, "To him that overcomes." And then right next to it, this is a promise. In other words, if I go through this and I overcome this, not by myself, yes, I'm going to have to go through some things. It's going to feel like I'm alone, but God will meet me there. Some of the greatest revelations I ever got in my life when it felt like I was most alone in my life. And God said, "Hey, I got something better for you, but you're going to have to go through this just for a minute." It says, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame." And he's talking about in the Garden of Gethsemane when he's sweating blood because he knew he was going to have to go to the cross. He says, "Because I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne." I'm sorry. "I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne." There are times in my life where God said, "Coby, not right now." Those alone times, those, you know, you're fighting battles and you're trying to get through them. You just need to leave it. Now, maybe it's not right now. Maybe it's just leave it. You know, and I go back, what do we need to leave in 2022? And I go back and I look of all the devastation and the hurt and thinking, my God, that hurts. You know, like we're Christians, we're going to church, we're having... There's toil and torment, and you're like trying to push through and make it, you know, and it's like, dang, are you leaving me here? You know, how many times have we felt alone and you thought you were doing the right thing? And I'm going to encourage you, you are doing the right thing. Because when there's something good trying to happen, there's always something evil trying to stop it. Man, that's good. Yeah. And so, but I have overcome because of God. At the time, I thought he was mad at me, and God is not mad at you. In fact, he loves you enough to correct you and stay with you. It's your job to repent and move forward. And we talk about this, you know, at our ranch. We move on in our realm. You know, we have these conversations with people and it's like they leave or they, you know, they got to go, which is fine, you know. And but always saying we're not waiting on you. God's a God of progression. God's a God of new things. He's a new season. By the time you come back, it won't look the same. And so what? So don't expect me to be in the same place I was when you left. Because when you come back, it's going to look different. And so we move on. And you think God, you know, like you think of God, like we don't talk about the God that disciplines. We don't talk about the God that's, hey, you can't do that anymore. Hey, you can't make dumb decisions and can't have your cake and eat it too. Does that make sense? And the other day, Cass had got a note sent home, and it broke my heart. I was disappointed. I knew I had to discipline my son, but this was different. It wasn't just I'm going to spank him, but I had to teach him something. You know what I mean? It's like this is a teachable moment. And after I had disciplined him, we sat and we talked, and I had to break it down into pre-K terms. You know what I'm saying? And so what can I tell my pre-K son that you can't make dumb decisions? You know, like you can't do dumb things and not get in trouble for it, you know. And so I was tearing up and I was like, we're going to have to, you know, it was felt like God was saying, I want you to just take them and you're going to pray with them today. And so I disciplined and I sat and I talked with him and I said, I love you enough to not let you stay in this mess. I love you enough to say you're doing wrong. I'm going to discipline you and we're going to move on. But let's pray. And so we prayed, we held hands, and I said, Lord, we just come to you, and I thank you that Cass is just going to make a better decision today, and we're just going to leave it at that. You know what I mean? And so a lot of times it's like God comes, we make dumb decisions. He says, you can't do that. Whatever happens in your life, and he says, you know what? You just need to make better decisions today. And I actually wrote back in the book to his teacher, said, Cass will make better decisions today. And I just left it at that, you know. And so if she has to call him out, I'm thinking, look, if you'll just tell this boy make a better decision, he will remember what happened. You know what I'm saying? Like, just, you don't have to tell him to get up. You just say, hey, you better make a better decision today. And he'll hop up, you know. And I know it. Romans 8:28, and it says, and we know that all things work together for the good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. And I want to talk about the disciplining of God. In Hebrews chapter 12, verse 4, it says, You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speak to you as sons. My son, do not despise the chastenings of the Lord. And that chastenings means correction and discipline. Nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. If you endure chastenings, God deals with you as sons. For what son is there among a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastenings, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. Furthermore, in other words, I just want to break it down to you, because we think, you know, like, if God's talking to me and dealing with me, I'm a son. And so if you're in a mess right now and God's talking to you and he's dealing with you, you are a son or a daughter of God. That means he loves you enough to say, hey, I'm disciplining you. I'm taking you through this. That burning on the inside of you that says, I know I'm not doing the right thing, but I want to do better. That's God, and he loves you because you're his daughter and you're his son. And you're okay. You're human, and God made you. And don't let the enemy or the devil talk you out of that. I'll go back to, furthermore, we have had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of the spirits and live? For they indeed, for a few days, chastened us as seemed best to them. But he, for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Now no chastening ceased to be joyful for the present, but painful nevertheless. Afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. And everyone needs to say, I want that fruit. That peaceable fruit. Nobody wants the discipline and the correction, but they want the fruit. You know, it don't feel good, but it's good for you. In Matthew 7:20, it says, you will know them by their fruit. Jesus is always talking about the fruit. He's always talking about the fruit inspector. That's right. Cutting off the bad, pruning, I'm throwing on the threshing floor. This will be burned. This will be cut down. And I don't have to ask you about your life. I can see the fruit of it. Yeah, you know, if we sit back and watch people in their lives, and especially now on Facebook, they put everything on Facebook, and it's like, I don't have to ask you about your life. I can see it. You know what I'm saying? Does that make sense? That's why it puts a magnifying glass on faults. You know, when you put all that stuff out there, it just puts a magnifying glass on your faults. It's like you crash harder because you put all this stuff out there and you can't take it back, and now you crash, and now there's a magnifying glass on it. And that's for somebody in here. I don't know. I wrote that in my notes, and I was kind of, yeah. But as I look back over my life, I remember all the hurts and suffering, failures and upset, and the men that would discipline me over and disciple me over me in the rough, tough love that would mold me into what God wanted me to be. God wastes nothing. I mean, I had some tough, mean men in my life growing up, and it was like you wanted to be those guys. I wanted to go work cows with my dad and my uncle, and you're probably going to get hollered at. They're probably going to cuss you. If you get close enough, they're going to kick you kick something, or going to put a cow over the top of you. Like yesterday, we were popping firecrackers at Casco by, and I was like, that's my son. I'm going to throw that firecracker at him. You know what I mean? Like, I could do that. He's mine. You know? But it was like, so then we're shooting each other now, you know, and so he'll be tougher for it, you know. But I look back over those times in my life, and God wastes nothing. I had my arm broke at a young age, and they thought it was funny. My mom didn't, but I'd never go back and want to change that. You know what I'm saying? I am who I am today because of those. They wasn't soft on me. They wasn't easy, but it made me into the person I am today. And you think, man, those guys don't love me. Man, they do love me. They love me enough to say the world is a tough place to live. There's going to be things that happen to you that you're just going to have to get over it and move on. In 1 Samuel 15, verse 21, verse 1, and I always go back to this, but you just underline or write this down, and in your time you go read it. But the Lord's telling Saul to destroy Amalek. And I preached about this a couple Sundays ago. And Amalek is a worldly system. It's evil. They were the relentless enemies of Israel. And I want to ask you this morning, what are your Amalekites? What is the Lord telling you to take out this morning? Before you move into the new year, we're starting off good. And he's saying, I want you to leave some things behind. I want you to destroy some Amalekites in your life before you move on. I want you to destroy some of the worldly things. Like, you're here this morning, you've made a good choice, and you get to make the choice. You can leave that behind and pick up and move on and go on to new things. You know, there's some worldly things that even in my own life, there's some worldly things that I got to move on, because it's not that God's mad at you, it's just because where God's taking you, those things can't go. And I seen a deal. It was Tyler Perry. He was at Joel Osteen's church, and it was a rocket, and he shot a rocket up, but the boosters fell off. And he's like, those boosters were meant to shoot the spaceship up, but where the spaceship is headed, the boosters can't go. And so you're rocketing up. You're moving forward, and there's some things, maybe some relationships, some people, they don't get to go with you where you're headed. And that's all right. You're not broken. You're human. But to obey is better than sacrifice. And the difference between sacrifice and obedience is I can tell you what to sacrifice. As a leader or spiritual leader, your spiritual leader, I can tell you, hey, you need to sacrifice this. You need to sacrifice this. But I can't tell you what God is telling you to obey. Only God can tell you what to obey. And each person in here, God's telling you something, and it's your job, it's your choice to obey that, whether you do or you want or whatever. And as we dawn the new year, we take a look at the things we left behind and the things we're going to be faced with in the year to come. Make it the best year of your life. Make this year the best year of your life. My 2022 was the best year of my life, but I got a new year. There's a new season coming. Yeah, we faced a lot of hardships, but it was the best year of my life because it got me to 2023, and I know God's got something waiting for me here that just molded me into where I can receive what's going to come in 2023. And I want to ask you this year or today, what is God asking you to leave in 2022? We were driving down the road the other day, and me and a couple of friends, and they were just talking. It was like, man, you're a good guy. You go to church, and man, you got it all together. And the Lord just really snapped it in my spirit. He says, no, you're not. And I was like, yeah, I know this, but how can I relate to them and tell them that I'm not? I'm not the greatest person. I'm not good. You know what I'm saying? In their mind, I'm the best, or, you know, not the best, but, you know, it's like, well, you go to church, you got it all together. And I said, man, I don't go to church because I'm good. I go to church because I need God in my life. I don't go to the doctor because I feel good. I go to the doctor because I'm in a bind. Kelly, she goes here, and I always call Kelly. I'll have one time I had a split forehead, and I sent her a picture. I said, you could see the skull, and I said, does this need stitches? You know what I'm saying? And so she's like, yeah, yeah, it needs stitches. And so we get that taken care of. And then it was like 2 years later, I split my leg open, and I get home, and I pick my pants up, and I mean, it's split. You can hold it open, see the leg, and I'm like, I text her, I sent her a picture. I said, this needs stitches. She said, yeah, it's like 2 years later. So I get there, get to the doctor, they're stitching me up. I said, one day, Miss Kelly, I promise you, I'm going to call you just to find out how you're doing. I'm not going to call you because I need to be put back together. You know what I'm saying? I didn't go to her because I felt good. I call her. I'm in a bind. There's something hanging. I could see something I ain't supposed to be seeing. You know what I'm saying? We don't come here because we're good. We come here because we know we need help. I need help. I need help not to want to blow up at people driving down the highway. I need help. And that's okay. That's why we're here. That's why we have God in our life. And so as we start off the new year, we're going to invite families to come and take communion together. And you guys can stand, and David's going to come up. But yesterday I had a conversation with my grandma, and I go outside, and we have an office there, and our office kind of out front yard. And I'd go in. My grandma is a prayer warrior. She sits in her chair. And I'm telling you, thank God for your grandma's at prayer. And so I'm sitting there. And talking to my grandma, and I said, I didn't know what communion was. I didn't know. I'd been in church all my life, and then they were taking communion, and I didn't know what it was. I just did what the guy next door to me was doing, you know. It's like, I didn't know. And so that's why we're here. We have to teach and learn what we don't know. And communion, the definition of communion is the sharing or exchanging of intimate thoughts and feelings, especially when the exchange is on a mental or spiritual level. In other words, it's just you and God. It's just you and God. We can stand here and we can point the direction, but you need to know what communion means. And in 1 Corinthians 11:28 says, but let a man examine himself. And so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. And we're not going to do it right now, but they're going to send for your families. If you want your kids, you go get your kids, or they'll send them down, correct? Yeah. And just starting off this year, we're going to take time to reflect. It says let every man examine himself. In other words, we're going to take a minute. And what's God telling you this morning to leave back? Because he's got something so much better for you in 2023. And just looking back, every time I left, it's like the teddy bear. That deal just blows my mind. It's like this little girl's got this teddy bear that God gave her. And it's a little teddy bear, and it's her teddy bear. And Jesus is standing there, and he's got his hand out, and he says, give me that teddy bear. And she's holding on to that teddy bear. She does not want to let go. And if she'll give him that teddy bear, he's got a bigger teddy bear waiting behind his back that she can't see. And so what is God telling you to let go of today that he's got something so much more bigger for you tomorrow? It says, but let every man examine himself, and then we'll move on. But we aren't living for ourselves. The decisions I make reflect the people around me. The decisions I make today will determine the outcome of my days, weeks, months, years, and eventually my eternity.
Yeah, that's right.
I always have an eternal mindset. I when I do things, it's like, what's this going to look like in eternity? You know, it's easy to say, man, this feels good today. Let's go do whatever.
Yeah.
It feels good. You know what I'm saying? But I have to have an eternal mindset. I always felt like when I was in those darkest hours and times and going through those pains in my life, that I was like, man, this hurts. But it was building towards my eternity for my family. I didn't even have a family yet. But I'd ruin one, you know what I'm saying, to be honest.
Yeah.
And it's like I learned to have an eternal mindset, not to be so temporal. I know right now you want to blow up on somebody. You want to, you know, whatever you face. I mean, life ain't easy. Josh and I had Christmas Sunday. I mean, like, good Christmas. You know what I'm saying? Like, things are happening. We got the most cattle we've ever had in our ranch. I get home. Kathleen did a little hair pat, hay rack. And I'm like, well, that ain't good, you know. That ain't mine. It's Josh's. And I would rather call anybody in here and say, hey, you got a dead cat. But Josh, I don't want to call Josh, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, it's your brother-in-law. You don't want to call your brother-in-law on Christmas and say, hey, man, we got a problem. Like, Merry Christmas, you know? And so it wasn't easy. It's like, well, what are we going to do? I don't know, you know. Like, I just know that was dead and there's another one to follow. Like, something's going on. We had to fix it, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't easy.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We got together. Next morning, we made a plan. We're back. We're back good, you know what I'm saying? Did I expect that to happen? No.
Yeah.
No, I didn't. Oh, was I going to blow up? And you know what? And now, in all of eternity, I'm not worried about those calves now. There's nothing I can do. What can I do to keep that from happening again years down the road?
It's good.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And today you have made the good choice to have an eternal mindset.
Yep, that's good. You know, and the thing about those calves is they could have just sat around and watched them all die. And they would have. But the decision they made was, we've got to put forth the effort to fix this. And it's effort. It's work. Because they all had pneumonia and they all had to have shots and clear them up and work. And too many times we go through life and we see the problem over and over, and yet we don't make the decision to go, you know what? This is Christmas. It's inconvenient. Listen, it's never convenient. If you know anything about the cattle business, it ain't convenient. They don't ever get out between the hours of sunlight and when it's nice, and they just don't work that way. And it's the same way with our eternal mindset. It's work. And it can be uncomfortable. And it can stretch us. And that's what the transformation that's going to take place this year. And so what we want to do to start off this new year, I feel it is vitally important. First, let me speak to you men. You're going to lead your family in communion. I can't think of a more powerful way is that your family see you lead them in communion. Because all through the Old Testament, what God put forth is that you bring the lamb into the house. And they would pick the best lamb in the house. And they would examine him for days. And they would examine that lamb. And they would look through it. And that lamb would become a pet. That lamb would become part of the family. Can you imagine? What, you know how you sit there and watch a puppy? And you're just all over that little puppy, and you're watching that puppy, and everything it does is funny except when it poops on the floor, but you clean it up and you still put up, but you it becomes family. And then comes the time that the father would have to take the lamb and he would have to slit its throat. He would lead the family and the kids would be like, Daddy, what is this? This is for our sins. This is for our sins. This is so you'll remember that our God is making a way for us to get back to Him. This is so that you will know. And that's one thing I've always told our kids. We may not do everything perfect, but you're going to know our God's God. Because no matter what mistakes we make, or no matter what bad choices we make, we're going to stick this out, get it right, so that you'll know that our God is God. And as we take communion this morning with our families, if your child is not here yet, they're coming. You can go get them. But men, we're going to set these elements up. There's some in the back. There's some here. So men, make your way to them. Get them for your family. We'll get your family here. You could just make your way to get them. Maybe somebody's sitting next to you. Maybe you might be new here today. This is going to look a lot different. And I know you might be nervous sitting there going, I don't know how to do all this. That's okay. That's all right. You may just have a fiance or a girlfriend or something. You can lead them. You can do this. You can do this. You might be in here. If you're a lady that you're in here, by yourself, come up here and take communion with me and Winnie. And it's all right if the kids are going to cry. Paul is addressing the church in Corinthians. He says in verse 23 of 11, he says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus in the night in which he was betrayed took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" And it really jumped out at me that he would say, "This is my body. This is my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." And in our culture and in our time in this, we forget. We need to do this and remember the body that was broken, the blood that was shed for a new covenant that restores our life, that forgives our sin, that redeems us, it reconciles us back to God. That's a powerful moment. And he took the time and he said, do this and remember. And guys, it's our job. It's our job to bring our families and say, this is why we do this. This is why we do this. Because Jesus' body was beaten, tore apart. He shed his blood on that cross so that we can receive mercy and grace. Son, this is why I'm here. This is why we go and we worship this God, Jehovah, Jesus that came and died on the cross. This is why we do this. This is why it's so important that we're faithful and that we're steadfast and that we learn and that we honor God. This is why we do it. Because there's a new covenant that we're now a part of. And it sets us apart from everything else. And I look across this room. I see families and lives that have been put back together, restored. I see restoration. I see changed lives. Only a body that was beaten. And here's what I want you to do. You men, as you're with your families right there, it says examine. Guys, we need to examine where we missed the mark. That's what he's saying. Examine. Examine the body rightly where we've missed the mark. Where we've missed the mark. Because see, that's what sin is. It's just missing the mark. And through this, it helps us hit the mark. And we examine that rightly.
This without examination,
without judging rightly, is just a snack. So, as you pray with your family, tell them why we do this. Pray for the new year that's coming. And it says, therefore, whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body, the blood, and of the Lord. But let a man examine himself. In other words, test, look at. And so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks it, drinks judgment to himself if he does not judge the body rightly. For this reason, many among you are weak and sick, and a number sleep. But if you judge ourselves, but if we judged ourselves rightly, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are disciplined by the Lord in order that we may not be condemned along with the world. I can look at myself and go, I missed the mark right here. I missed the mark right here. I should have been a better husband here. I should have been a better dad here. Come on. And so when we judge rightly, then we allow ourselves to be disciplined, what Coby was talking about, and God set us right. And we're not condemned. Listen, we're all going to be pulled to a deeper and a higher level with God this year. And it starts right here.
And it starts right here. So you take time with your family and you do this in remembrance of Him. Pray with your families. I'm excited for a new year. For a new year. How amazing. Father, we come to you. We thank you for the many families here, Father. I thank you for the reconciliation and the restoration, the redemption, for your grace and mercy. Father, I speak healing. I speak healing. Spirit, soul, and body. Lord, I speak restoration, reconciliation. Lord, I speak to the dry bones. Lord, I pray that those bones begin to come together. Lord, I pray that they live again. Lord, I pray that brokenness be mended and healed. Lord, I pray times of refreshing. Time of refreshing. Lord, I pray for clarity of vision. Lord, I thank you right now. Things that we've believed for, we'll begin to see those bones and sinew and flesh begin to come alive. Father, I thank you for what you're going to do this year. For what you're going to do this year. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Love y'all. We will see you Wednesday.